Alright, good morning everybody, or good afternoon, whatever. This is going to be another Petit Computer tutorial, but unfortunately I don't have my other HD camera, so the video quality is going to be very poor. Let's begin. This will be a slightly longer video, not showing off anything, but rather, a tutorial video. I hate long intros, so let's get started. Gonna wanna go to write program, which is up there. Okay. So this time, we're gonna make a game. It goes into game. Variables, data, information, put an output, the buttons, sound, beeps. First thing we're gonna do, because we want beeps, is we're gonna go beep 5 to find out what the 5 beep is. No. So, you can look for sound effects for your game this way. That's not the beep we wanted to hear. Beep 7. I'm sorry that I'm going so fast. That's one of the most annoying ones, by the way. I hate hearing that one. Huh? Beep 9 appears to do nothing. I'm just experimenting right now to show you guys how you could experiment as well. You could also experiment with input B equals BTN bracket bracket. It has to be button, right? Derp. B equals button bracket bracket. Enter. Go up. If you have your cursor on the left side of a line, then you hit enter. It will bring that line down, which allows you to put a loop around it. Like so. So for loops or labels, you want to put an at sign. It's right there. And then type something like main or my loop or main game loop. You can name it anything you want. All you have to remember is that when you use your go-to statement, because you can't do regular loops in this game, when you use your go-to statement, you have to, also I'm sorry for the coughing, I'm sick right now, you have to do this, go to at sign, it has to be the same name as the label you're going to, otherwise it won't know what you're talking about. This is just a brief introduction to labels. I have sort of gone over them before, but not like this. Okay, so run. Run Rudolph. So it does nothing right now. That's because we need to put a vsync in the CLS. I think I've gone over this before, but I'll go over it really quickly again. Vsync, and in some of your projects you may not need it. It's usually used for graphics and sprites. By that I mean it's used for graphics and sprites in order to cause them to actually appear on the screen. So as far as I understand it, it's vsync 1 and then CLS. For text, and for graphics it'd be also, you'd add a GCLS or whatever as well. Sprites don't ever get erased from the screen as far as I'm aware. They stay on screen even if you clear the screen. You'd have to use SP clear, but that I think also resets all the sprites' locations. So unfortunately the only way to really move sprites is to actually move them off screen by moving their coordinates and using SPOFs, which I'll get into in a second. So here we got main, B equals button, vsync 1, CLS. Go to main. It's looking pretty good, but doesn't do anything useful yet. So, to do something useful with it, I'm going to type locate in here. And what that does is it sets the text cursor where print goes. And I'm going to put 0, 1, because we want it to be the first line down. And I'm going to put print underneath that. I'm going to put print there. And I'm going to type... I'm going to type B, print B. I may have to put a str dollar beside it, we'll find out in a second. I think you only need str dollar if, it's working. So up is 1, I'm pressing up when I do that. Up is 1, down is 2, right is... Hmm. Red is 8. It's hard to tell from the 0 with this video. 8 and 0 look similar. You can see the slight difference. And B is 32. You can see all this in the help, but this is a simple program to let you tell what each button does. B is 32, which we'll get into in a second. A is 16. Cool. So then X is 64. Y is 120. And you can do this yourself. So if I'm going too fast, L is 256. R is 512. Start is 1024. Okay, so that's buttons. On to the next thing. You can click stop down there. This run will change to stop, and you can click it, or you can press select to stop your program. Beware, if you're not in edit mode, it will actually quit completely. Okay, so go back to edit mode. Okay, so we should be in edit mode now. If you're following along, great. If not, just try to learn from this, because that's why I'm doing this. I'm trying to help people learn. So, we'll leave that print B there, because it's useful for now for debugging. You can always tell what button's being pressed that way. Now, to make use of that B, we want to put a square on the screen that can move up, left, right, or down. So what we're going to do is, we're going to do some coordinates. Oops. This is, I'm going to take you through how coordinates work now with the buttons. So let's say we have PLRX equals 100, roughly the middle of the screen, and PLRY equals 100. That's roughly the middle of the screen. Now let me explain. The X value, if you look at these grid lines here in edit mode, they're 8 pixels by 8 pixels each. So if you had a character on your screen and its X was across, then that would mean that each time you added 8 pixels to your little character, which would also be the size of one of these squares, then your character would move one square over, then one square over. So each time they move by 8 pixels, they're actually moving by one of these little grid squares. And then player Y, the same thing except up and down. So X is horizontal and Y is vertical. The higher the number here, the lower down it goes, and the higher the number here, the more to the right it goes for X, and for Y it's up and down, so you don't get confused. So yeah, it looks like my friend might be home in a minute, and if he is, he may walk in the door and start talking through my video. I'm not going to bother editing it out, I'm sorry. I want to continue this tutorial. The show must go on, so if he speaks, just be warned. This is pretty impromptu. You might get a laugh out of it, I don't know. Okay, so I explained that, but not very well. We'll go into more detail. Those numbers, that's not the 100, that's not 100 of these little squares. It's not 100 of those little squares. What it actually is it's 100 pixels. Each of these little squares is 8 pixels. So each of these is 8. So this is 8, 16, 8, 16, 24, 32, and it just goes on. Each time you go down a square, you add 8. You can move your players by 1 pixel. Once they've moved by 8 pixels, they'll move down one square. This is just to give you an idea of how the distance in Petit Computer works for sprites, because a lot of people don't really know, they don't really have a sense of how far over so many pixels is. Okay, so moving on. Pause this for a second. Alright, and yeah, moving forward, I decided to pause the video. No use putting useless things in your tutorial. We're going to create a square now using GBox. If you haven't used any of the graphics commands before, they're very great for simple things. So you type GBOX GBox, and then you have X1, Y1, X2, and Y2. And then you have the radius, which is usually like, I usually use like 8, And then you have the color, which, if you know what your PVC palette is, this is probably bluish. Okay, so let's run that and see what happens. Syntax error, gbox, and let's find out why. Gbox, x1, y1, x2, y2, 0, 5. I wonder what could be going wrong. Get rid of the 0 and just put 5. Right, because it's not a circle, it doesn't have radius. Of course. Okay, it worked. Stop. Okay, edit. I'm sorry, that mistake is because I'm tired. So, now, this will be really easy. What we're going to do here is we're going to do some assignments. Instead of having to change this line of code to deal with the player, we're just going to add new code that makes it compatible. This is adaptive programming, and it's very simple when you first start out. All you do is you take the x1 equals player x, okay? PLRX. X1 equals PLRX. That makes it really, really easy. And then Y1 equals PLRY. Now, to give it dimensions, we need to add a certain amount of coordinates separating X1 from X2 and Y1 from X2. The reason is because these work in points. So, on a screen, this would be x1, y1. This is actually a point. It's not just a single variable. Each dot in our matrix, in our two-dimensional program, is actually two points. It's not one point. Okay, it's technically one point. But what it really is it's one point made up of two coordinates. The two coordinates are x and y. Remember how before I told you about the horizontal and vertical values with player x and player y? Well, the reason why we need x and y and not just one of them is because otherwise without the y, the vertical location wouldn't really be defined, and without the x, the horizontal location wouldn't be defined. So the x is actually the horizontal location on the screen, so we could assume, say x is like 100, it would be about here roughly, but where's the y? This means that r squared could be anywhere going up or down the grid, but we know where it is roughly across. That's why we need the y in there as well. Without both of the x and the y, you will not be able to get proper coordinates. So you need to figure out how these work, and I'm trying to help you. So let me explain. The x1 and y1 parameters of this are the same as the box's x1 and y1 parameters. We're taking the player's x and y coordinate, and the player doesn't need two x and y coordinates because we're making up second coordinates for the player, so it has dimensions using the box. So the x2 and y2 coordinates are the distance between the x1 and y1 coordinates. So if the x2 coordinate is 10 and the x1 coordinate is 0, that puts 10 pixels between the x1 and the x2 coordinate. That means the top left corner of the square and the top right corner of the square are going to be 10 pixels apart. If x1 was 0 and x2 was 20, then that means the top left corner of the square and the top right corner of the square would be 20 pixels apart. And as you go on, not across this line, but as you go on along the horizontal axis, your square will get bigger and bigger. But you also have to define the distance between two points for the y coordinate. So you could have a square that's not perfectly square by, say, if x1 was 0 and x2 was 10, there'd be 10 pixels across. No matter what, no matter how long, no matter how far down it is, the square would still be 10 pixels across based on just the x1 and the x2 coordinates. As for the y1 and the y2 coordinates, they alternate because this is the first point of the square and this is the second point. So say if your y1 coordinate was like, say, 5, so it starts at 5 pixels on the screen, that'd be like roughly here going down, and your y2 coordinate was like, say, 190, if your Y2 coordinate was, like, say, 190, your square would be as long as the screen almost, because the screen is about 190 pixels. So the difference in distance, like the difference in numbers, actually correlates directly to the size on your screen, and that size is measured in something called pixels, similar to when you learn what a centimeter and a millimeter is. So think about it like this. Pixels are like your millimeters. These little squares here are each 8 by 8 pixels, and then each of these squares is like one of the smallest possible sprite graphics you can have if you're dealing with sprites, which is 8 by 8. And if you want to get bigger sprites, you get 16 by 16, which is 4 of these, or 32 by 32, which is 16 of these. It gets complicated, but we'll keep it really simple for now. I may be wrong about the 16 part, but anyways, basically all you have to do now to fill this in is type in x2 equals x1 plus 8, because that's 8 pixels. So let's say x1 changes from 10 to 20. No matter what, then if x2 was originally 18, x2 would then become 28, because as x1 changes, x2 changes with it. It's locked to this other value in the code. Because we're adding 8, you can view this as an algebraic equation, x2 equals bracket x1 plus 8, and as x1 changes, so does x2. If you don't know algebra, just think of it like this. x2 is always the value of x1 plus 8, and because this is inside our main loop, there is nothing in our code that will ever change this, so you can rely on it. If you were to start messing with the x2 and y2 variables down later on, before the gbox, but after these statements, then it wouldn't be reliable. So do not change the x2 and y2 variables after this code, unless you're drawing a different box for a different object. So, and we'll get into that later. So now, we're going to do y2 equals y1 plus 8. Same thing. Y1 will always be, or y2 will always be the value of y1 plus 8, which means that y1, think of it like this, x2 will always be 8 pixels away from x1, and y2 will always be 8 pixels away from y1. That's what the 8 is for. If you change the 8, it would change the distance in pixels that these two values and these two values are apart, which would actually scale our square to be bigger or smaller. The size is actually measured in two ways. It's first measured across, horizontally and vertically, and then it's measured between the top left corner of the square and the bottom right corner of the square, because the x1 and the y1 coordinates are actually the top left corner, and the x2 and y2 coordinates are actually the bottom right corner. Now, this being said, the bottom right corner can always move up or down independently of the horizontal axes. So when you add length, when you add more pixels to the y distance, that is the distance between y1 and y2, you're changing the height of the square only. And when you add more pixels to the x1 and x2 coordinates distance from each other, you're changing the horizontal width of it. So if you wanted to make a square that was 32 by 32 pixels instead of 8 by 8, you would change these 8s on this line and this line to 32, and that would basically do the magic we're looking to do here. So let's run it now, and I'll show you what this does after I fix that error. So just hit the run button. Bam. Oh, look at that. It's square. And we can't move it yet or do anything. It doesn't react. That is because, a lot of you may be wondering, but we put button code in. Yes, you did put button code in. B equals button and print B. But there's, in order to make a playable character in a game, you need to link your button code to the player's, you guessed it, x and y coordinates. Luckily, we don't have to move the x2 and y2 at all. We only have to move the player X and Y, which will automatically get plugged into the X1 and Y1, which will automatically, because we wrote these coordinates here, these four lines, which will automatically, I should say five lines, because there's a space, but it would automatically calculate for us at this stage. So all we have to do now is make a few if statements. It's only four if statements to make the player move, assuming the player is the box. Make it move by 1 pixel. No, 2 pixels, so you can actually see. So, okay. If B equals 1, then PLRY equals PLRY minus 1. Like I said, the smaller the number, the higher up on the grid. And the bigger the number, the lower down on the grid. So we're moving our box up by 1 pixel each time the up button is pressed with that line of code. That's all it does. It says, move the value decreased by 1. It's not saying move the player. The program doesn't understand that this is the player. All it knows is that, oh, you're subtracting from this number. This box commands here and these coordinate setting commands here actually turn that into the player code. But the program doesn't know that we're actually dealing with the player. All it knows is that we're taking values away from something. It doesn't need to even know what the values are. That's kind of the magic of programming. Usually, your programming language doesn't understand what you're really trying to do. It just understands what it's being told to do. And that is true with all programming languages. So you really have to know what you're doing, because if you don't know what you're doing, then your programming language won't know what you're doing. And it's true in all languages. If B equals 2, okay, so let me explain. We did our button test before, and if you remember, those different values, when we press different buttons, that's what these correlate to. So if B equals 2, and by the way, we're using two equal signs here, if you guys didn't know, when you're doing a comparison statement, when you're trying to check the value of something, you need two equal signs. When you're assigning, that means when you're setting the value of something, you need one equal sign. There is a difference, and you'll get errors in your if statements if you only use one equal sign. You'll get a lot of errors. So try to not do that. Okay, so if B equals 2, with two equal signs, I'm emphasizing this, then PLRY equals PLRY plus 1. That should move it down. I know I said I'd do 2, so I'm going to change that to 2 really quick. Okay, and the other one. I may have to break this up into 2 parts. I don't know yet. So I'm going to click run now. And I'm not dealing with the other coordinates yet, just these ones. So run. Okay, so we've got our box. So, oh, look at that. What's going on? Why is it creating a line? There's a reason for this, and I'll show you that reason in a second. We need to put, reason it's doing that is because it's drawing the box, and then the box moves, and then it's drawing the box again. But CLS, like I said earlier, doesn't clear the box, it only clears text. Otherwise, our print button thing would be spamming text down the screen. So we need to put a GCLS there. You should only ever use GCLS once in your program's loop, ever. Don't use multiple GCLSs unless you're dealing with a lot of graphics, because it will create some ugly flicker, especially with VSync. So, and even then you get flicker sometimes, because Petit Computer can't handle a lot. So hit run. Okay, so there's a box now. When we move it this time, it should not leave ugly lines. So, I'm pressing up and down here on the D-pad, and it's moving up and down, which is the entire purpose of this. And you can still see our button code firing away, 1, 2, 1, 2, like I said, those codes, the equals 1 and equals 2, they correspond directly to what button's being pressed. So, yeah. But, if I press left and right, what happens? This is what I was talking about before, the grid. You need two sets of coordinates, because with only the one, you'd be like, your character would be stuck in like one spot. You don't have free movement. So it'd be really boring to play a game like Pong where you can only move up or down. It'd be great if you're trying to make Pong, but otherwise, yeah. So, moving on, we're going to... Oops, you don't want to start the light. Okay, moving on with our program. We're going to go back into edit mode now. We're going to save. If you don't know how to save yet, in edit mode, you have edit here, and you have save here. We'll run. You need run to save. And then you type, you can click save on the top here, save. Your program name should only be about 6 characters. If it's any longer, you might get issue saving. I don't know if that's the exact amount, but I'm going to name mine 888. So down here it says, all will be saved, okay? You click yes. I'm sorry if you already know a lot of this stuff. I'm trying to make my tutorials as comprehensive as possible so that anyone of any level of experience can pick up a video and start learning. Okay, so we've got this gbox here command. This gbox command here, that draws everything so far, except for the print command. Excuse my coughing, please. So next we're going to do the left and right. So we type two more if statements here. If b equals... Oh, and by the way, without the b equals button command up there, this will not work in your version if you try to copy me. You need that b equals button. Emphasizing this, every single piece of code I've typed, if you omit something, if you leave one of the things I typed out in your example, you will not get the same results. So the next is b equals 4, which is left, then plrx equals plrx, that's player x, minus 2. You can see that clearly. And then we're going to do the inverse of it, which is if b equals 8. I'm sorry, 8 isn't the inverse of 4, but the following is. Then player x, which is the player's x coordinate, player x equals player x plus 2. This will move the player to the right. So each of these lines can only move the player in one direction. Kind of like, you need one line of code for each button for moving the player. Then you need another line of code for each drawing command for each object. Then you need another line of code for... Then you need 4 more lines of code for setting the coordinates for each of the boxes. I know that sounds like a lot, but it's really not. People who made Petit Computer did their best to make it as simple and easy to use as possible. There was a lack of video tutorials in their website and in the general communities, and I know that it's really outdated that these are coming out now, but there's still a lot of people who want to use this app, so maybe I can help you guys out and make your $8 Canadian or US purchase towards Petit Computer worthwhile. So now I'm going to run it again, and I'll show you guys what's been done. So now, as you probably expect, you can definitely move the square up and down still, but now you can move it left and right. So now you've got a moving square, which is the beginnings of a playable character in a game. I know that I've already done like a sprite tutorial with movement, but I went pretty fast, and this just sums up more details about what can be done and the ins and outs of it. The purpose is to like basically have it so you guys can learn on your own. That is, that you can take what you learned from this video, or from my videos, and find a way to make something new out of it, or find a way to use different commands together. So yeah, that's an excellent start. Hopefully the video wasn't too lengthy. You may be thinking, aw, crap, you know, you said you were gonna do, like, tutorial videos, and how come I'm still stuck just moving a square? And this is boring, and I don't like this, and why can't you teach me more complicated things? And I'm just going to show you really quick why that is after I save this example. Because I know that's going to be a question or a thing that people are probably thinking. I'm going to save it as 888 again. Save, yes. And it's like, oh man, this is beginner stuff. Why are you showing us this? Show us how to make, like, an RPG. Show us how to make, like, a Final Fantasy game. Show us how to do, like... all these things, and I will get to those things but I'll show you something here. file management. You can stop watching this if you want now, because the tutorial part is over. But yeah, we'll go to write program. I'll show you guys bits of my Zelda engine so you can see. Okay, so this is bits of my Zelda engine, and I'm gonna run it first so you can see. What's this? Oh, out of data. Oops, loaded the wrong one. What do you know? This might work, or this might totally glitch and crash. This may be the right one. Okay, this is bad colors, but basically you have a scrolling Zelda-style game engine that isn't even complete yet. You're probably thinking, oh wow, that's cool. It can scroll off-screen too. I've been working on this for months, but not straight, like on and off, like in spurts. I made all of the tiles, like, in, I made an editor that, my computer uses, that I use on my computer, I mean, to, place all these, and then I made a program that exports them into Petit Computer data, and doing that took me about 4 days to actually get the data right, and it still isn't completely right. There isn't even any mobs or any collision or anything like that, and I know most of you are like, oh, probably like, teach me how to do this, and I will get to that, but now comes the problem. I'll show you the code. So we're just going to scroll through this code slowly. I'm using Disco Stew's engine, the Subplaytron, that gets skipped, and I have random EGM, so these are loading. This is arrays. This is dealing with loading the map from data statements. This is BG clip and BG offset. That sets the scrolling speed. These are important parameters to the game engine, including the player X and player Y. You'll notice something similar in my tutorial. Player X and player Y. So the update full back to Disco Stew's function that he made. There's the random BGM play SP set. That's my sprite. Main, okay, so here's my main loop. This code alone just handles the scrolling. Look at this. You have to understand what all this means. And then there's some more sprite commands. There's more if statements for scrolling. There's gbox commands that were commented out in a later time. There's jump commands from old. There's bleh, that's a skipping command. It's a skipping function. That was old. There's vsync 1. There's a whole bunch of scrolling conditions again. There's my button conditions for play movement. I'll show you those really quick. You'll see some similar things. So there's the player X and player Y equals minus 1. Try to scroll. So this is different if statements for different button presses and the player's current location on the screen. So if the player's current location is a certain value, scroll right gets set to true, scroll left goes set to true, etc. And no move, it goes to no move after doing that so that it skips movement, because otherwise it'd be scrolling all over the place. And then this is just BGCX and BGCY are map coordinates in Disco Stew's engine. They're how far the map is scrolled and such like that. That's a Disco Stew function again. BGOffs. That's just to scroll the screen to the right place, and that's something else. So here's our scroll right function, our scroll left function, scroll down function, and scroll up functions. So scroll amount is 24, and scrolling up is true. It goes back here after that. It goes all the way back here, and then every single time it loops, it takes away one from scroll amount. Scrolls the screen over or up or down or left by 1 pixel, or rather by 8 pixels to make a tile, and then it does it again, and once scroll amount hits 0, scrolling up is false. If any of the other scrolling values are true, then none others can be set. That means only one scrolling value can be true at a time. this isn't even done yet. And in order to get all those tiles on the map, I did not use a typical map editor. I'll show you what I did. Those are old jumping codes. Here is the map data. We are on line 300 right now. I know you can't see it very well. 300, 400, 425, 430, 440, 450, 460, 470, 480, 490. Please keep in mind, I did not type all this myself. I copy-pasted it from a program I made that converts the tile data I put on my screen on my computer into this data. It generates the notepad file, and then I copy the notepad file into PTC utilities. I save it as a PTC file, then I run append, and I attach it to the program. Then the program reliably reads the data because it has a read function at the very beginning that knows the exact amount of data it's looking for. And my program on my computer also outputs the same exact amount of data that it needs. Oh, we're still scrolling down. Mind you, this is a lot of map data. A lot of you guys, if you're making games, you won't ever, ever use this much map data. Ever. And if you do manage to find an excuse or a reason to, kudos. Because it's very hard to manage a lot of data. This isn't even really technically a lot of data for me, personally, because I have it all organized and separated. But just to give you an idea, we're still scrolling, and we're at line 1,200 now. This isn't programming code, this is just the map information that's stored in my program. This is why my Zelda engine is taking so long to finish. Okay, and that's a done tutorial for now. As always, if you like my videos and you learned something, please comment, subscribe, share my videos with your friends if you want who use Petit Computer. Drop a line in the comment section if you feel so inclined and let me know what you thought. Maybe if you have any questions, any tutorial requests, any ideas, if something confused you, just whatever, you know. Yeah. Thanks for watching.